it's an honor to be here tonight with you, Paul, and it's really wonderful to think about how so much can change in just 4 years, especially for you. but I think back to when I first met you, which was in 2009, right after Bellevue Literary Press published Tinkers, and when I hosted you at a small bookstore that I ran events at in New Hampshire called River Run Bookstore. And I still remember that I had already introduced hundreds of authors in my time as events coordinator there, but when I introduced you, I was shaking. I was so nervous because because
I'm so intimidating.
Yeah, exactly. No, it was, you know, I couldn't stop gushing about your book and how much it meant to me. And it really is a cliche to say this, but your book has changed my life.
It was good to hear this.
So it's just great to be here with you. And I thought that we would start out by having you read from your new book, ENON, that Random House just published.
Sure, I can read. I'll read a whole chapter, but it's a page and a half. So, and then maybe as we talk about different things, I can maybe read another page or two. But this is so Enon is the protagonist of Enon is a guy named Charlie Crosby, who's the grandson of George Crosby, the protagonist of Tinkers. And the basic dramatic premise of Enon, when Tinkers sort of went on its worldly way, I started thinking about Enon. I was thinking, since Tinkers was sort of kind of dense and melancholy and sort of tragic, that I'd kind of move more in the direction of musical comedy. And it didn't work out. Didn't work out at all. Turns out I'm a serious person. So the basic dramatic premise of Enon is that Charlie has lost his only child, his daughter Kate, who was 13 years old, and she's struck and killed while she's riding her bike home from the beach one day. Subsequent to that, Charlie's already very sort of fragile marriage unravels, and his wife leaves. He and his wife separate, and much of the book is him trying to somehow or another kind of trying to improvise a way to become equal to the circumstances, the tragic circumstances that have befallen him. And along the way, he ends up breaking his hand and getting painkillers, and he becomes addicted to the painkillers and drinks a lot of whiskey and stuff like that. So, and what he ends up doing is wandering the meadows and the paths and the lanes of Enon, which is the small village that he lives in on the north shore of Boston. And most nights he ends up in the cemetery where his daughter Kate is buried. So this is just a little chapter that almost sort of encapsulates sort of his predicament, particularly when he's sort of gone pretty much as, you know, down the tubes. So. Late one winter night after the new year, which came and went without my being aware of it for 2 weeks, after I had lost track of how much whiskey I had drunk, I lapsed into a blackout and awoke nearly frozen in the cemetery 6 hours later. I was laid out on my side, stopped up against the backs of three closely laid headstones for three sisters who had all died on December 12, 1839, at 8, 7, and 5 years old. I was sure that my toes and fingers had frostbite. By the wind and the barest light in the east, I could tell that it must be after 5 in the morning. The sky was still full of stars, but they were not the limpid, tame stars of an early summer evening. They were cold, wild, staring, and ferocious. They were stars that had arrived in Enon's sky from the deepest trenches of space, from terrible, unimaginable beginnings. Their light democratized by the present moment, but in fact a vast, tangled thicket of times, of ghosted universes haunting the hillside with their artifacted light. Their light unsettled me the way the open eyes of a dead person would, because it is impossible to believe that open eyes do not see. Their light blazed in the eyes of Enon's dead for a moment in false resurrection. I rose and convulsed from the cold and retched from the poison. I looked over at the snow-covered golf course where kids sledded every winter and imagined the dead having sledding parties at midnight on the back slope of the hill, warming their finger bones in blue fires that they kindled in granite urns, laughing when they held their hands inside the flames. I imagined them melting clumps of dirty ice in a tin bucket over the fire and drinking the hot, muddy brew and cackling with glee as it ran off the backs of their jawbones and spattered down their ribs. I imagined them using headstones for sleds. The idea made me nauseated, and I repented of it. I had the urge to go to Kate's stone and kneel in front of it and say, "I'm sorry," over and over again, because no matter how much I knew better, I could not stop myself from stepping over the same dark threshold, night after night, trying to follow her into the country of the dead in order to fetch her back, even though she visited me in dreams and never left my waking thoughts. Memories of her feeding the birds and practicing running and playing cribbage were not enough. I was ravenous for my child and took to gorging myself in the boneyard, hoping that she might possibly meet me halfway or just beyond, one night, if only for an instant, step back into her own bare feet onto the wet grass or fallen leaves or snowy ground of the living Enon so that we could share just one last human word. So that's chapter 7. Thank you.
Well, I think that was the perfect passage to read, because one of the first things I wanted to talk to you about is your incantatory rhythmic prose that often deals with nature. Mm-hmm. And it's just astounding. You see it in Tinkers, you see it again in this book. And does this come from your musical background?
I think it partly does. As you heard, I was I played drums for many years. I never called myself a musician. I played drums, you know. We can get to the dumb drummer jokes later. That's a large repertoire of those. But I do. I write intuitively in a way that's similar to, say, improvisation, musical improvisation, which is that I write rhythmically. I often intuit the almost like the time signature and number of beats that any given sentence is going to have before I know what its literal meaning is. And I just have, again, a very sort of intuitive, improvisational, and kind of idealistic way of composing, you know, prose, which is that I feel very passive in it. I feel like I'm just the amanuensis. I'm just there to sort of take dictation from the cosmos. And sort of whatever comes over the wire, if I'm sitting at a drum set, I'll just start tapping out beats and improvise, you know, that way. And if I'm sitting at a laptop, it will precipitate into prose, which just, it's just naturally, aesthetically, and just according to my disposition, tends to be that kind of lyrical, kind of almost like lyric prose, almost like poetry.
I would say, I don't know, you sort of remind me, I guess I would compare you to Cormac McCarthy in how both of you use nature and landscape almost as characters in your books.
Yeah, I think in Enon and Tinkers to some extent, I want that. I mean, in Tinkers it's more the landscape, and Enon it's more the town almost, but
right.
The town is a little pastoral village. And you want it to reach the complexity where it almost becomes like a mind, which is the hallmark of character too, but the idea that it's complicated, and that the sunset and the snow and the rain and the birds and the trees are almost become like thoughts in a mind, just so you can get that kind of aesthetic quality out of them, the intimacy out of them.
But the characters also seem to, you know, find truths about themselves through nature as well. Is that intentional?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I don't think I ever write about a landscape to write about a pretty landscape. It sort of has to do with aligning the subjects and the predicates properly, but so I don't think I ever write about, as much as I love to write about, you know, sunlight and creek water and birch bark metaphysics and all that, I never write about a landscape per se. It's always a landscape being perceived by a character, so that the description of the outside, the natural world, is refracted through the consciousness of one of the characters, almost to the point where that angle of refraction actually is character. So it's always landscape perceived, and then hopefully what that does is that just that deepens the reader's understanding and experience of the character.
So what's more important to you when you're writing, character, plot, the sentence level? Do you think that one is more important than the other, or they're all critical?
Well, they're all critical because it's narrative prose, but it, character is absolutely what I'm interested in. I mean, and this is, you know, God bless plot, but I just don't think in terms of plot. I think of plot as a predicate of character. I think of it as an emergent property, as they say in physics, which is that I'm interested in knowing the person I'm writing about. And so to me, the hallmark of, you know, all the writing I do is just, I'm interested in this person. I'm interested in character. The hallmark of character is consciousness, you know, mm-hmm. and the hallmark of consciousness is perception.
And speaking of character and your writing process, I know that a lot of times you've talked about truth in fiction being incredibly important. Why is that?
Well, I don't know. I always. It's funny how anecdotal these things are. But I remember when I was still more just an avid reader, but wanted to be a writer. Mm-hmm. And there was something that always struck me as slightly off about fiction writers who would get up at events like this and say, "I write fiction because I'm a pathological liar." You know, because the second I started to try to write fiction, I felt like my job as a fiction writer is to write sentences that are absolutely true. Yeah. And then that, you know, that broke open onto all these ideas, you know, exploring all these ideas about that there's imaginative truth and this factual truth. And so getting at the sort of aesthetic or imaginative truth of a character, of a description, is essential. It's of the essence.
What do you mean by imaginative truth?
When I'm, you know, I write interrogatively. I'm always trying to write to discover what it is that's true about a character. In early stages, it just has to do with just sort of trying to empirically build up descriptions of what a character's seeing, what a character's thinking, all that sort of stuff, until you hit a little bit of sort of critical mass, or the character, or the work of art, as it were, sort of hits a certain, achieves its own kind of momentum and starts to feed into itself and generate its own necessities, its own truths. And as a writer, I'm always, you know, endlessly fascinated by that, the kind of negotiation you have to do, where there are times where you have to sort of impose your will on the text, but then there are times where the worst thing to do is to sort of insist on something. That's when you start grinding axes. That's when your writing turns pedantic, as opposed to just trying to just listen and watch and just precisely render what it is that the character or the material is kind of presenting to you.
Well, let's talk about actual truths, because I know that in your inspiration for Tinkers came from real life, that your own grandfather repaired clocks and your great-grandfather had epilepsy and left the family when your grandfather was 12, because just like in Tinkers, his wife was going to try to put him away in a commit him to an asylum. How much of Enon comes from your life?
You know, a lot of it. It's fun. Charlie, c'est moi. You know, I mean, I think there's a number of factors that go into it. One is that I had an uneasy relationship to memoir and autobiography. Again, sort of circumstantially, you know, my age. But I remember when I started becoming aware of things like these things. There was, at the time, it seemed like there was sort of a glut of the sort of confessional memoirs that I just found distasteful. And so I had this, you know, naive kind of amateurish reaction, which was, I dislike all this confessional stuff, so I'm going to set all my fiction on Mars, you know, in the 25th century. Like, I'm going to get as far away from my own autobiography as possible, with the result that I could just, you know, I have many, many, you know, sort of banker's boxes full of execrable, you know, writing about Mars in the 12th century. You know, and I finally realized, you know, it ended up being a very simple formulation. It was sort of, I mean, writers in the crowd, you know, you have to, these things can be agonizing to finally arrive at. But the kind of formulation I ended up with is more or less that while I could not be less interested in autobiography, I could not be less interested in myself as it were. There's nothing I could be more interested in than the fact that I am a self. And so once I sort of got that proper, just sort of, again, formulation for myself, then I suddenly realized the virtues of being able to use facts, as it were, from my own hometown, you know, where I grew up, because I know the landscape, I know the seasons, the milieu is right at my fingertips, which is just a blessing when, in the example of Enon, I gave Charlie this incredibly difficult subject to write about and incredibly tragic subject to write about. And I quickly realized that, if this book is about a man who has lost his only child, if I take one wrong step in any direction, the book is going to lapse into sentimentality and bathos and melodrama. And so it was good to be able to give him the landscape and the people and things with which I was very intimate, so I didn't have to think about those things. I could concentrate on his experience of the predicament I had put him in moment by moment with the finest nuance I possibly could, which was my own kind of more or less, rather than, you know, come to some huge dramatic moment and wondering, oh, you know, what flower would he be looking at in Nevada in November?
Right, because the geography of this book is your actual hometown that you
grew up
in.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, it is.
So both of your novels have to do with death. Tinkers opens with George Washington Crosby, who's the grandfather of Charlie and Enon, on his deathbed. And Enon opens with his grandson announcing that his 13-year-old daughter was killed by a car while riding her bicycle. And I'm wondering if you write about death in order to write about life.
Well, sure. I mean, I think I think of it as, well, some of my favorite writers write about mortality. You know, to me, it's very intimately connected with transcendentalist writers. You know, the sort of guardian angel of Enon for me was Emily Dickinson, who, and one of the reasons why I love her is because she makes the boundary between living and dying totally permeable. She moves back and forth. A lot of her poems are these sort of first-person posthumous narratives. I had no sooner died than, you know, my neighbor, you know, said, I died for love, you know, whatever that. And that's one of the things that I immediately knew about Enon was that one of the ways that that Charlie was going to try to negotiate his daughter's death was by, in his imagination, basically not accepting it. And taking his memory of her and sort of repatriating her in with all of the people who had ever lived in his hometown. And so he needed to be able to pass back and forth between that sort of. So that just opens up onto all sorts of things that I'm interested in sort of metaphysically and transcendental philosophy and all that sort of stuff. It also just works because it's great counterpoint. You know, death is the great ultimate stark background against which to set in relief these largest issues about sort of the human circumstance. And it's funny because I never think of myself as writing about death.
That's yeah. True. What do you think? Really?
It also has to do with just thinking, you know, trying to always keep the subject and the predicates in the right place, which is, I don't, you know, in this sounds a little coy or whatever, but I don't write about death. I write about Charlie, who is confronting the death
of his daughter.
So again,
it's back to the character rather than the.
Yeah, and it's just making sure I don't write about grief. I write about Charlie, who, because the danger is with sort of anything, but it's, you know, fiction doesn't work by argument. It doesn't work rhetorically. It works, it works by description and by immersion. It's experiential rather than argumentative. So the problem is if you make, say, grief the theme of my book, and then you take this little paper doll of a character and you staple him to grief, then you just put in this terrible, you know, you're in danger, you're liable to putting yourself in this terrible situation where in order for your readers to consent to your book, they have to agree with what you say about grief sort of abstractly before they can consent to giving themselves over to this person narrating his experience, whereas Charlie narrating his own subjective experience, you can't deny somebody their own experience of these different things. And it makes for a much more sort of, it ends up actually making for a more, ideally if it all works, universal portrait, you know. Yeah. Fiction is portraiture, you know.
But in dealing with these really incredibly serious topics, you're actually one of the, believe it or not, the funniest people I've ever met. And I'm wondering if you've ever thought of writing a comic novel. Is that something that even interests you?
No, sure. I mean, I think you have to, I just sort of, it's strange. I mean, I whenever I deliberately try to write comic material, it falls flat. It just turns into spoof or parody.
It's hard to write comics.
You have to have a certain disposition for it. And just mine just becomes kind of antic. And I just feel like I'm the little kid who makes, you know, your parents and your aunts and uncles sit on the couch where you're doing handsprings in front of them. You know, like, yeah. it seems performative to me in a way that the other stuff doesn't. But then, I mean, I think this is another thing people may disagree, but I think parts of ENON are funny. It's just, you know, it's maybe cosmic humor or something like that, but it's also very deadpan.
Yeah.
But it's kind of, it's a little bit more subdued, but I think there is some cosmic sense of humor in the books.
There definitely is. But what is it, when we're talking about characters, what is it about fathers and their children, which you deal with in both books, that you're drawn to?
It's so funny because I experience all of these things as I don't think any of this stuff up beforehand. So again, mm-hmm. I don't think about, oh, I think I'll write about fathers and sons. It's just it's just I naturally just am channeled toward it. I think that in both the case of Enon and Tinkers, it's just that I'm thinking of my grandfather and I was thinking of his father because just circumstantially, that's the sort of book of Genesis for my own family. And that was the sort of the mysterious, semi-legendary kind of, you know, farthest reaches back that anybody in my family could remember. And it just happened to be my grandfather and his father, that lineage. Mm-hmm. And then in my, you know, with Enon, it's just, I'm a father. So in that sense, it was just more, I could access Charlie's experience more easily and more immediately.
Have you thought, though, of maybe writing a book that has a female, main protagonist?
Yeah. I have. And I mean, I think, you know, there are different characters in the two different books who I'm sort of maybe writing a little bit about. But it really just has to, again, it's just, I feel like there's only, you know, so I'm only two books in, so, you know, we'll see.
Are you working, is the third one going to also be set in?
I'm hoping it is, yeah. I just started writing a couple of little things about one of the characters in Enon, who is a woman. So we'll see. We'll just have to stay tuned, I guess.
So I wanted to talk about also how the adult female characters aren't as central as the male characters. Why is that? Is it just because you're drawn to, not drawn because we've talked about this, but because you were writing about these male characters at the time?
Yeah, I mean, again, it was just, in the case of Tinkers, I actually, Tinkers was the mother in the family, a woman named Kath, character named Kathleen. There was actually a whole section of the book that was all about her life before she found herself in the family of Tinkers. And with that book, it just so happened that every time the book shifted gears and kind of turned her into a co-protagonist, just the book just started to wobble off its axis and it just didn't work. And then I actually tried to write like a novella about her. Okay. And the problem with her is just in that book, she's embittered. She's had an incredibly difficult life. She finds it difficult to be equal to. And I just ended up writing, everything I ended up writing about her kept kind of turning into satire in some ways because the problem with embittered characters is that they are, in the most literal sense of the word, monotonous. They're monotoned. Their bitterness is the one note they strike over and over again. So that when I started to try to give her different, give the story that contained her different textures and different tempos and feelings and keys.
The same
and
tone, pretty much.
It was either that or it was just ones that I imported from the outside that started to turn satirical. And I felt my loyalty to her ended up being best exhibited by leaving her alone. And she's one of those characters I really feel I really feel loyal to her because I couldn't get her right. I couldn't do justice to her the way I wanted to.
I liked about her how she's an unlikable character. And, you know, actually unlikable characters are some of my favorite characters. There's been a debate. There's always this debate, but this year in particular, there's been a debate where Claire Massoud and Jennifer Weiner got into kind of a thing on the internet about, you know, whether, you know, what the plus sides are of unlikable characters. And what are your thoughts on that? I mean, I think that Charlie, you know, he's definitely unlikable at some parts with where he's so consumed by his own grief that his wife, you know.
She splits. I think if you put your characters in serious enough situations, in, you know, the human predicaments that people, you know, Greek tragedy, Shakespearean tragedy, all these, you know, you put your characters in these universally, you know, these universal and sort of essential human predicaments, you're going to get, just by nature of that pressure and them trying to be equal to it, you're going to get the worst and the best of any character. And so Charlie behaves poorly through a good amount of Enon, and hopefully the difference, though, is what I'm trying to always keep the reader's interest and loyalty to the characters through the deeper human connection of empathy rather than sympathy. You may not sympathize with what he's doing, but you empathize, which is just that you recognize how he has come to these predicaments moment by moment as he describes his experience. The other thing that I was able to, that I had a great time, it was difficult, but it was substantive and fun to work on in Enon, was that I gave him self-awareness, so he knows he's not being a good guy. You know, like a large part of Enon is him wrestling with his conscience, him struggling with the fact that he knows better than he is acting. And that's another, to me, that's just a, you know, sort of quintessential human predicament. You know, I think St. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, of course, you know, where he sort of says the evil that I do not want to do, and I don't do the good that I know I should be doing, and that sort of is shot through all of human experience. I shouldn't have another whiskey, and yet I do, and you know I shouldn't, you know, I, you know, all the way to these kind of like larger moral things. With Enon too, the way that Enon came to me, it came to me as just as an image. It was almost like a silhouette cutout of a hillside that was studded with gravestones, and there was a solitary figure sort of creeping across the top of the hill. And I just knew all at once that that person was Charlie Crosby, that it was very late at night, that he had been, you know, he was creeping home after a night of misadventure, and that his daughter was buried down at the bottom of the hill. And along with that, I knew all at once that this book was a solo. You know, it was a sonata, it was for one voice. And so unfortunately, I killed off the rest of the family. And, you know, I just knew that it was going to be a sort of existentially sort of stark kind of thing, where it was just, he just had his own resources. He had to fall back on his own resources to try to negotiate this tragedy. And in that sense, I knew it was going to be like a prayer, like a hymn or a psalm or a lamentation, spoken or sung or whatever, but cried out by one single voice. You know, it would have been a different book if his marriage had persisted and that had been folded into the book too. I just knew it was sort of a single voice.
When you talk about the hymn, I know that we've talked about how in the past, when I interviewed you for Bookslut several years ago, about how you read a lot of theology. Mm-hmm. And when I read your work, I can't help but think of Marilyn Robinson, who you studied with.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what is it? Why do you like to read theology, and why do you like to talk about that in your work?
Well, I started reading theology. I liked to read, in the beginning, I liked to read theology because I liked Marilyn Robinson and I wanted to have nice conversations with her, and I knew I had to, you know, come up with something interesting to keep her attention. Otherwise, she'd, you know, sort of, hey, aren't you a nice, interesting young man? You know, and sort of, because I grew up atheist, not by doctrine, you know, but just by, there was never any religion in my household. Mm-hmm. And then it occurred to me, you know, over the course of studying with Marilyn and reading her books and becoming friendly with her, that if I ever asked her directly what the source, which she would cite as the source for her own intellectual and aesthetic and spiritual sophistication, was she would cite her own religion. And given the fact that I would be inclined to believe Marilynne Robinson when she said, I just said, well, if that would be her account for herself, then I should maybe look into this. It's probably something substantive if Marilynne tells me that there is. And so I just started reading Calvin, and then I started reading Karl Barth and all of these theologians. And what I found was just this absolutely, you know, to my reading, you know, stunning cosmological narrative understanding of the universe. It is poetic. It is aesthetic. It is narrative. It's not meant to be scientific, as it were. It's sort of it takes different terms than science. It's not meant to be, at least the Reformed theology that I find myself reading. It's not fundamentalist. It's not based on it being factual. The truths are spiritual. They're interior. And so I just love it because I love time. I love cosmology. I love this experience of being in time. And you know, so I find I find the Bible to be as true as I find Moby Dick to be true, which is not to degrade the Bible down to the level of narrative. It's to say something about the kind of sacred nature of narrative itself.
Well, it's funny you bring up Moby Dick because there's something Melvillian about your writing sometimes too. And is he an influence on you, especially
sure.
growing up in New England?
Yeah. And this is with Melville, with Marilynne Robinson, one of the things I do not suffer, among the many things I suffer, one of them is not the anxiety of influence. I experience influence as joy. Like, the reason I write books is to talk back to my favorite authors. So when people say, oh, you kind of, you know, I can tell you, you know Marilynne Robinson. Great, I love it, you know,
yeah.
Aunt Marilynne. And you know Aunt Emily and Uncle Herman and you know and I think of them as my aunts and uncles, and it's familial, you know. And so as long as I feel like my books are not merely derivative or imitative, yeah. then that's great.
What about great. Proust? I mean, you're obsessed with time and memory.
Yeah,
and
I love Proust.
You know,
yeah.
your sentences yeah. are a lot shorter than his.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm not sort of a sybaritic kind of French. You know, like, it's just I adore Proust. But you get sort of closer to home with the, you know, Hawthorne and Melville. And Melville is just, you know, Melville I learned probably through Marilynne Robinson, but just about extended metaphor. If you look at Moby Dick, it's basically, you know, he takes the ship, the Pequod, and almost just cuts it down the middle, and it's almost like a cross-section of the ship, and he just goes sort of job by job, position by position, takes each thing, turns it into this just absolutely splendid, virtuoso kind of extended metaphor for the cosmos. And then just as you're sort of completely at your highest, deepest level of enchantment with, like, yes, you know, the Cooper making his barrels is like the way God must have made the entire universe, he pops the bubble and says, stop all this daydreaming, you're going to fall out of the crow's nest. And I love that idea of just enlisting, like, a vision of the whole universe, enlisting your belief and your heart while it lasts, and then suddenly it's just gone. So you believe it while it's actually, you know, while you're actually reading it down the page, and then when it stops, you sort of, it's gone, and yet it had its own integrity while you believed it, and will regain that integrity every time you go back and reread it. So yeah, absolutely, Melville's work that way is certainly modeled.
Do you think that every work of fiction, contemporary and classic, is at its heart about time and memory?
I think it, in some ways, I think it must be, but that's because, again, the way I align these things and sort of, you know, sort of align them and look through them sort of telescopically is the hallmark of writing to me is character. The hallmark of character is consciousness. The hallmark of consciousness is the experience of being in time and remembering. And, you know, because in your mind, you can do all sorts of things with time. You can go now and then and there and here. You can explode time. You can compress it. You can accelerate it. You can decelerate it. This is all loops back into how I think about it musically, too. But, you know, you experience time in such a, I mean, who knows what time is?
So how do you look at it when you're, so the difference with writing Tinkers, which, you know, it goes, as you were saying, it talks about three different generations, whereas Enon is very much focused on Charlie and his daughter's life. How do you approach it differently when you're writing Enon versus Tinkers?
Well, with Tinkers, I was able to just sort of jump among generations of the family because it was written in third person, written third person, second person, first person, present tense, past tense, I just let myself jump all over the place with that. With Enon, it's just since it's written in first person, I was not able to do that. So I just took what I like to do with time and memory and thinking about generations, and I gave it to Charlie. So what Charlie does dramatically, that becomes a dramatic aspect of his character, which is he takes his daughter and thinks about her in the 19th century, in the 17th century, and in all the different sort of superimposed times of the village, so that the village then becomes almost like a cross-section of times and eras, which he imagines her sort of wandering through as a way of sort of, I mean, I think of all of this stuff as he's kind of an amateur historian, he's kind of a dilettante, he reads the town records and all that sort of stuff. Which is what I did with my own hometown. They're incredibly boring, you know. They're all about boundaries of farms. You know? Joe's, you know, the cherry tree to the rock. He had those modest resources, and what I do is I have him put Kate into that town history as a way of mediating the impact of her death, which, you know, it's, I think of it as like Perseus and Medusa, almost, which is if you look at the terror or whatever of reality, stark reality, without any mediation, you'll turn to stone, you'll perish. Your heart will break and you'll drop dead. But if you have that mirror, which for him is, or that lens, which for him is all of the town history that he's so familiar with and so intimate with, he can look at her death through that and somehow or another, and that's what he tries to, and it's out of that, looking through that lens, it's out of that that he tries to improvise a way to survive it, and not feel like he's shaming himself or his daughter, because, you know, he's lost his only child, but he's still a parent.
And some of those hallucinatory parts of the book are some of the most powerful parts of the book.
Yeah, he really loses his mind. Yeah, and that really was kind does. Of, you know, and that's sort of fun for me to work on too, because that's when you can.
What did you do to research for that? Did you take any painkillers, Paul?
No, I've never taken a painkiller in my life.
I'm kidding. We both spent a lot of time in New England. Obviously, you grew up there and still live there. And I feel like the cliche about the hardscrabble New Englander is kind of true. And I'm wondering how living in New England has shaped your writing.
It's absolutely, utterly shaped it. Yeah, because it's just imprinted on me on a cellular level. One of the ways I describe Tinkers, or sort of what the motive for writing was, that I feel like still to this day, whenever I'm writing, I'm still just trying to articulate what it is that I experience when I'm in the woods, say in the middle of November with the sun going down through the trees. Just that quality of light, you know, because it's just being in the woods in November with the light going down is where I was when, you know, I was a little kid, when I was an adolescent taking painkillers. No, but wandering innocently around the woods, wandering not so innocently around the woods or whatever. But it's just that, you know, just light, you know, the way that light enters, you know, I associate that landscape, that local, local parochial landscape with the most intense emotional experiences I've had. And so I just, those landscapes and that New England milieu, as it were, is just what also just opens my own heart up the quickest and fills my heart.
Hence why the transcendentalists are so important.
Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely, yeah.
I think we're ready to open it up to the audience for questions.
I have a
see someone right there.
Do you have a question over here? All right, let me get to you as soon as I shouldn't have worn heels.
But you talked about, first of all, thank you. It's really a thrill.
Oh, my great pleasure. Thank you for coming out.
Okay. You mentioned a few things that were fun to write about. Can you tell us about some things that weren't fun to write about?
That were not fun?
Yeah. And also some things I'm also curious about some things that didn't make it into this last book, and if those have any correspondence to fun or not fun.
Oh, fun or not fun. No, I don't know. It's. I mean, I don't think in terms of fun. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know, because I really don't think of it in terms of fun, because I think of it in terms of difficulty, and in a way, some of the most satisfying things to write are actually the things that are the most difficult to write about. So like on any given day, I might be ready to, you know, sort of take a swan dive off the top of the chimney because I'm, you know, because it's, but then at the end of the process, it's sort of that proves to be in the end kind of the most fulfilling thing to have written about. I mean, what's fun for me are writing just sort of, you know, just like sort of big, vivid, there's a scene in Enon, for example, where Charlie imagines Kate as a part of this big, almost like opera production, which is very, very elaborate and very phantasmagoric and sort of kind of very Halloweenish. And so that was very fun. I mean, not emotionally, it was difficult because it's sort of at a, you know, kind of his low point emotionally in a way. But just staging that was very pleasing, like becoming a set designer in a way and a costume designer for this couple of pages that happened. That was very pleasing.
Other questions?
Sure. Thanks for the presentation. Really lovely. My question is, when do you put the pen down?
When do I put the pen down? Oh, that's interesting. It's just been the case in both instances with Tinkers and with Enon. I write very, I mean, Tinkers is the chronology is kind of all over the place because it's interior, so it works associatively. Enon has a little slightly more external kind of time frame to it. It happens over the course of about 12 months. But I wrote both books in a completely haphazard way. I'd get up and I write whatever interests me that morning. And if the next day I'm not interested in that scene, I just go to some other part of the book and write about it. And I think of it almost as like a painting in a frame. And I just know kind of roughly where the boundaries are, usually. And in both cases, I just had more or less, you know, days where I finish a day's writing and I think, that's it. It's all there. Like I filled the volume of the book. And then it becomes time to print it up and then actually start the kind of physical act, you know, physical job of aligning everything and getting everything so that it moves in sequence. I think that has to do also with writing in terms of character rather than plot more. You know, I have the whole character is on the page. The entire emotional spectrum of this experience is hopefully in the pages that I mean, it's advance and retreat because sometimes sometimes you think, oh no, there's another scene to write, you know, that sort of, you know, but it's intuitive. But in both cases, I just felt like, yeah, I think I've pretty much got it. I feel like I've said everything.
Oh, sure.
Thanks.
I know you. This could be bad. And the heckling starts.
When did you know that Enon was a book that was worth pursuing as a book? Like, when did you think it was a viable project?
Ooh, I don't know. That's interesting. It's. I guess I knew it about 4:30. I don't. You know, it's one of those strange things where you sort of. I mean, when I write books, I just sort of like the whole experience is sort of one of doubt, but hopefully it's productively focused doubt. So I'm always worried. I'm always worried, like, you know, was it good up to here? And then for the past 50 pages, it's not been good. I mean, it's just a way of just sort of vetting the material and just hoping that the whole thing kind of hangs together as you're trying to manage it. But I guess, in the earliest stages, you know, maybe when I had 50 pages, something like 50 pages, and still felt like I had more to say. Because, you know, I've worked on projects where you get 40 or 50 pages, and at a certain point, you think, am I still talking about this? Like, you just suddenly think, I've been going on for 20 pages too long, and then that's usually a sign that it's not working. You just sort of toss it.
Thank you. Hi. I'm interested in what you were sort of ending the presentation with, the idea of the audience experiencing sympathy versus empathy, and the idea that a lot of your characters see sort of the most beauty when they're in the worst spot or the mm-hmm. least happy, and sort of where you feel the audience lands in that.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think in terms of Keats, you know, Keats' formulation of truth is beauty and beauty is truth, what you find as true is what you'll find as beautiful, you know? I think a lot about what Wallace Stevens said about the act of poetry is essentially an affirmation of this human life, you know? And I think of Beckett, I can't go on, I'll go on, you know? And just the characters trying to find hope under the extreme threat of the possibility of hopelessness, you know? And so any bit of hope is always beautiful, you know? And so that then goes back down to, like as dark as Enon is, I always operated according to the idea that the deeper the darkness, the more beautiful and precious the light will be that he finally finds that he feels is true. And that will be beautiful, and that will be, you know, these books are not, the books are not hopeless. They death is in them, but they're not hopeless. They say yes, you know, to this kind of fraught existence that we all have, and that people will recognize that, and they'll find it moving, and they'll find whether the characters are acting sympathetically or not, they will be empathetic with, again, the kind of the ebb and flow or the ups and downs of always wanting to act according to your better self, but sometimes acting according to your lesser impulses, because I think we all do that to some extent.
My question seems kind of simplistic after that great answer, but I was wondering, when you were saying that you toss certain things that aren't working for you, do you find that you keep hold of those or recycle those? Are there pieces that you can't let go, you know, your favorites, and that you sort of maybe fit back in at some future time?
Yeah, you know, I sort of keep the sort of the proverbial file cabinet or card file full of stuff. And I mean, I have the luxury, because Tinkers and Enon overlap in the same fictional world, I love that idea. You know, Faulkner is kind of the role model for that, Yokna Potapa. Because one of the things I love the idea that this fictional world exists over the course of a number of novels. You know, that there's something larger, and there's something, and I think that ties in with, you know, one of my favorite experiences as a reader, and most powerful experiences is recognition on all sorts of different levels, and even down to the level of when you're reading a Faulkner novel that's about protagonist A, and you see one of the major characters from another one of his novels sort of walk across the back. I say, I know that guy. I read all about him. And suddenly the universe kind of gets bigger and more capacious and kind of just more beautiful again. You know? So I think, you know, any given thing that doesn't work for this book might work for another book. I think you have to kind of play your long game that way. And that even actually happened in Tinkers. There was a scene, it was just like a little page long extended metaphor to which I was particularly loyal and kind of in which, you know, with which I was in love. And it just didn't work. It just didn't work in Tinkers. And so I snuck it into Enon. It sort of like made, and it sort of kind of comes out of nowhere. And it actually ended up working because it's about birds and Charlie and his daughter in Enon spend a lot of time together where she, getting birds to come and eat from their hands. And so then when he has this kind of crazy idea that has to do with birds, it just makes sense emotionally in this case where it didn't work in Tinkers.
Little did I know,
but I was bound and determined to get that damn thing into one of my books, you know. Yeah.
We have time for a few more questions. Mary, yeah.
Okay. You was a drummer, and now you're a writer.
Yeah.
Now, when are you gonna do your true calling?
I know, you know, it's
stand-up comedy.
Yeah, no,
one funny dude.
That's what I say. My poor, long-suffering wife. You know, I was with her for, you know, so for the first 10 years we knew each other, I was a drummer in a rock band that nobody ever heard of. You know, making no money. And so then, when the band inevitably broke up, I said, "You know what I think I'm going to do? I think I'm going to write literary fiction." And she's like, Can't you become a lawyer? You know, can't you? You know, nobody was happier about Tinker's success than me. I mean, I was happy for my wife more than I was happy for myself when Tinker sort of. But now we joke, you know, along this. You know, so I say, you know, this writing thing really isn't panning out. I think really, I'm a dancer. I have the body for it. I have, the, you know. Yeah. But I mean, I do. They scratch the same itch, as it were. You know, I mean, drumming is. It's interesting because music happens live in the moment, and there's something about the integrity of the moment and the composition. The same thing happens when you compose in language. But then there's this cool thing in language where you can go back and you can revise. You can revise it, but it's still the same thing. It's still creative. It's still that kind of nice, that idea of you're making things and you're imagining things. You know, yeah.
Final question, anyone? No pressure. You got to make it good though, because this has all been really good.
One of my favorite, or possibly my favorite character in Enon, is Mrs. Hale. And I was thinking about her as Michele asked you the questions about the influence of New England on your work, and mm-hmm. she seems to me the very, very best of what New England had to offer in terms of a kind of imaginative role model when Charlie needed a slap.
Yeah. She gave him a good stern talking
so
to
I
her.
So I was wondering if you might want to talk about her a little bit.
Yeah, she's a character that actually, so there's this character, Mrs. Hale, who is a kind of, she's one of the matriarchs of this small village, and she comes from sort of half the houses on the village, I imagine, is having those little historical plaques on them, and the houses were built by her great, 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 great grandfathers, and they're all over, and so they're kind of one of the original families of the town, and so she's a kind of steward of this village and a steward of that kind of New England tradition that arises out of Puritanism and the sort of the theology of Jonathan Edwards, which sort of evolved into Emerson and the transcendentalism and Unitarian Universalism and stuff like that. And she just represents some kind of an ideal or she's a sort of personification of, you know, she's all the elements of New England and the light and the religion and the philosophy and the art, just sort of concentrated into this one person. And she began life as I originally wrote a short story that was narrated by a younger version of what turned out to be Charlie, and it was all about a slightly different version of Mrs. Hale, but that idea that he's sort of in awe of her and exasperated by her at the same time. She seems like she's sort of archaic and humorless and cold, but actually she sort of has this again, it's sort of like he has to find the deep and secret yes about her, because actually this sort of reserved demeanor that she has is actually the hallmark of a grace. She's gracious to him when he most needs it. She's gracious to him in a way that actually is, saves his life in some ways. You know, so yeah. So she might be somebody I might be writing about some more. I think she's fascinating. She fascinates me, and she is modeled sort of in some ways. She's a kind of. She's a collection of different people I sort of knew growing up. But there's a scene in Enon where Charlie remembers sledding with one of his friends down the hill on her estate, and he and his friends, there's a swamp at the bottom of the hill, and he and his friends bail off their sleds before they go out into the swamp so they won't get killed. And she takes exception to that. She sees them doing that. She comes out, and she accuses them of being unmanly in their sledding, and hops on the sled and goes whoop right down and goes off into the swamp. And that actually happened. There's a woman, this widow who owned this big estate. She actually came out and gave us a good dressing down, and then got the sled and went right down into the swamp. She said, "See, it's only cuts and bruises."
That's the thing, reading strange. Those characters, I feel like I know these characters. These are people who actually
they're really
exist.
Strange. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I would like to thank you both. This was a fascinating conversation to eavesdrop on.
Oh, thank you all for coming. Great pleasure.